Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh once again. So today, inshallah, I'll share the next phrase of the ayah of Ramadan with you. Yesterday we talked about the first phrase, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. The month of Ramadan is the one in which the Qur'an was sent out. Now Allah says three things about the Qur'an. Allah is describing the role of the Qur'an, this is called hal, in three ways. And let me just, instead of being very technical, simply describe what hal means. When you say, for example, a green car or a blue, you know, a blue wall or something, you're describing a color of an object. It's an adjective or a quality of something, right? Or a tall man. When you say something like a tall man, whether he's sleeping or standing or sitting, he's still tall, right? So that's not a quality that gets affected. A hal is not something that's a permanent quality that is dormant, meaning it's kind of embedded inside and it's there all the time. A hal is something that's living. For example, if I say a man walking is not a permanent quality, it's actually something you can see, it's an action, it's something taking place. When something is described in grammar as a hal, it's not just a quality of something, it's a living, experienced thing. So what I'm getting at here is the three descriptions of the Qur'an are hal, that doesn't just mean they're descriptions of the Qur'an, that these are qualities that the Qur'an has, but these are experiences that come from the Qur'an. They can be experienced. They can be, you know, they can be seen. They can be seen in action, right? So what are these three things that Allah describes as hal of the Qur'an? He says, hudan linnas, that's the first one. Then he says, وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّلَ الْهُدَى, that's the second one. Then he says, والفرقان, three things. And so over the next 3 days, we'll stop at each one. هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ, then بَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى, then الْفُرْقَانِ. So let's talk today a little bit about هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ. Simply translated, guidance for people. So what did I mean by hal? It means the guidance of the Qur'an isn't just some quality that it has, it's something experienced. It's something alive. It's something in action. It's as if it's not, it's like a living book. And its role is to actually serve as guidance. Another technical language thing that the grammarians talk about that's very hard to understand if you're reading the tafsir, but I'll try to make it simple for you, is that when you say there's a person that's going to give you directions, one says to you, I'll take you there. That person is your guide. That person is your guide. In Arabic, you would call them a hadi, a guide. But that person is not your guidance. There's a difference between guide and guidance. The one who's guiding you is simply a guide, but not guidance itself. Guidance is a much bigger concept. The Quran is our guide. So the expected word is actually hadiyan. Hudan linnasi, where he says, hudan linnas, unzila fihi al-Quran hadiyan, as a guide. But he says, as guidance. Now what difference does that make? When the infinitive is used, in simple English what that means is that you can't possibly get guidance anywhere else. This is it. This is the only guidance available. This is the ultimate guidance available. This guidance overshadows any other guidance. There may have been some guidance before in some other places, but it's like the Arab says, "Aghna al-sabah an al-misbah." Like when you have the morning, when the morning comes, there's no purpose for the lamp left. If you're lighting a candle at night, it has no purpose when the day comes, right? That's all the other forms of guidance become irrelevant because this is there. So this is the ultimate guidance. That's the first thing to note here. The second thing to note here is very important, that Quran makes a distinction, a separation between knowledge and guidance. Somebody knowing a lot of things, if you have a lot of ilm, you have a lot of information, that doesn't necessarily mean you have a lot of guidance. It's the same as, you know, you have the app on your phone with all the directions, you have the maps on your phone, you have Waze, you have Google Maps, whatever you have. You have it there, but if you don't use it, and if actually you're not actually looking at it turn by turn by turn, then all that information is useless. It's sitting there, it's inside, but it's not being put to use. Somebody can have a lot of information inside them, they can learn a lot, but unless they're looking at that information, constantly thinking about it turn by turn by turn, it's not guidance. So a lot of times we confuse the increase in knowledge with the increase in guidance. They're not the same thing. Increase in knowledge is helpful if we actually use it for guidance. And actually, sometimes you have people that have a lot of knowledge and never use it. And you have some people that have very little knowledge, but they always use it. They have little bit of knowledge, but whatever little they know, they put it to use to seek guidance. And Allah guides them. Like, I'm reminded of the story of the Ashabul Kahf in the Quran, Surah Al-Kahf, right? The people of the cave. These people were not scholars. These people didn't even know about any prophet. These people didn't know about any book. No revelation, nothing. All the only guidance, the only knowledge they have is there is a God, and the only God that should be worshipped is one. That's all they know. And that's enough for them to, because they committed to that one thing, that was enough for their guidance against the most impossible opposition. So that's the first thing here. When Allah says Quran is guidance, meaning a lot of times when we say I'm learning Quran, we emphasize the learning of the knowledge of the Quran, the grammar of the Quran, the tafsir of the Quran, the ilm of the Quran, the tafsir studies of the Quran, the academics of the Quran. But in the month of Ramadan, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, I sent this book as something that you will use at every turn in your life. And it'll come to life at every turn in your life. Like counsel. Like, you know, for some of you, whenever there's an important decision that has to be made, you call a friend. Hey, I just got this call. What should I do? Hey, I received this email. How should I respond? I have this offer. What should I do? Should I take this job or not take this job? You have someone in your life that you go to at every important turn. You text them right away. That's the kind of role Quran wants to play in your life, in my life. There's a choice that comes. I'm going to look in Allah's book. What would Allah want me to do? And that guidance will come to life. It'll actually come to life. That's actually the role of Allah's book. Hudan linnas. Now the last portion of this, which is linnas, for people. Allah is describing here, you know, some people, as they get closer to their religion, they think, well, if I come to the Quran, then things are going to get harder for me. Because Quran's going to want me to do things that are hard, that are my feelings go this way, but Quran wants me to go that way. Right? So it's going to be uncomfortable. It's going to make things more difficult. Allah says in this ayah, this guidance that Allah has offered in the Quran is for your benefit. It's for the benefit of all people. And that all people is so important, because the devil comes to people and says, you know, Quran is good for that person, this religious person over here, this guy has a long beard, it's good for him. But, you know, I have a different problem. Quran can't guide me. It's for them. You know, I have a different situation. Allah says this is guidance for all people, Muslim, non-Muslim, religious, not religious, knowledgeable, not knowledgeable, practicing, not practicing. It doesn't matter. Allah sent this book to guide the hearts and the minds of anyone who wants to seek its guidance. And it will come to life for them. And it will be there for their benefit. The lam here is for benefit. In other words, whatever guidance Quran gives you, the guarantee is that is the better road for you. That's actually, no matter how painful it looks, no matter how excruciating it looks, no matter how much you tell yourself, this, I can't possibly do this. This may be something somebody else can do, I can't do it. Allah says every single human being can do what I'm asking them in this book. They're capable of it. They are capable. If they were not capable of it, Allah would not make Quran for all of humanity. Allah would make Quran for some people. But Allah made Quran for all of humanity. All of them, at whatever level they are. However far they are from Allah, however close they are to Allah, Quran is still guidance for their benefit. So long as they are breathing, Allah has not given up on them, Quran is still a light for them. Some people might say, well, you read the Quran and you might get guidance. I don't think Allah will give me. Allah just opened the invitation. Allah said, this is something that will be alive for you constantly. Now, this one short piece that I want to add to this, on linnas, on for people, for the benefit of people. You see, the way we give guidance, the way we offer the message of the Quran, we have to think of one thing before we think of anything else. How is this going to benefit someone else? Allah, His priority is the benefit of people. Is the benefit of people. Which means your priority and my priority should constantly be what? The benefit of people. If the conversation is not going to be beneficial, then you shouldn't be having that conversation. The way in which Quran is presented, the way in which we share its message needs to be a way in which that people can see that you're saying this for my benefit. You know when you're yelling at someone? When you're insulting someone, you say, I'm doing this for your own good. Nobody thinks you're doing it for my good, bro. If you were doing this for my good, you wouldn't be talking so badly. You see? So when Allah says it's for the benefit of people, there's a mercy that entails in it. Here's the last thing. The month of Ramadan, the Muslims are very focused on themselves. Worship, fasting, iftar, Taraweeh, you're constantly around. Some people take off from work. You say, I'm not going to go to the office. I'm not going to talk to my friends. I'm not going to do anything else. Did Allah say that this is a month for the believers? This is guidance for the believers? Allah said about this month that this is guidance for who? All of humanity. You know the devils are chained in this month, right? The shayateen are chained. When the shayateen are chained, are they chained only for the Muslims or for everybody? They're chained for everybody. They're chained for everybody. Which means there's somebody who, if you shared the message of Allah with them in this month, shayateen will not bother them. They'll actually listen.
their heart will be closer. This is an opportunity to share the message of the Quran in this month. The angelic presence, the divine presence, the special blessings are so powerful. If there was ever a time you would share something about the Quran with your non-Muslim friends, from the friends that have distanced or drifted away from religion, with those people, if you were ever going to share something for their benefit from Allah's words, this would be the month to do it. This would be the time to do it, because this is for all of humanity. This is Allah comparing us to the Israelites, Banu Israel, in this surah before, because they believe the Torah and the guidance is for who? Just themselves, nobody else. You know, this is not for anybody else. And even within them, it's just for the rabbis, it's just for the scholars, it's not for everybody. But Quran came and said, no, it's for everybody. It's even for these ummiyin, these people that have no education, none whatsoever. Don't be intimidated by the Quran. Seek Allah's guidance. And of course, there are going to be levels of learning, and that's what we'll talk about tomorrow when we talk about bayyinatin min al-huda. Because the question that I leave you with, that you think about for tomorrow, is people say, well, okay, fine, you want me to get guidance from the Quran, fine, but I don't know Arabic, I don't know anything about the background, what if I interpret it incorrectly? What if I read a translation and I get my own crazy thoughts and that's not what it actually means? What do you want me to do then? You know, and that's a very real, practical question. I mean, if you want me to just open up the Quran and start reading it, then how am I supposed to get clarity or guidance from it? That's the question that will be answered when Allah says, وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَىٰ. That's the second role that the Quran plays. Once again, Quran plays three roles in this ayah. The first of them was the one we talked about today, Huda linnas. Tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala, wa bayyinatin min al-huda. And the third day, if Allah permits, wal furqan. Barakallahu li wa lakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Interruptions, Lamin?